Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see you out this morning. What a beautiful day we have to come to the Lord and worship. Excited that you're here. If you're a guest among us, we want to welcome you. I pray that you will experience the sweet presence of the Holy Spirit of God here, that you have come to praise and worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ with us today. We're excited about what God's got in store to share with us today from the Word of God. And excited that you're here. If you're a guest among us and you wouldn't mind to fill out the perforated edge on your bulletin, give me your name and number. I'd like to pray for you and be there if you ever have a need of any kind that I could help you with or the church might help you with. I do want to, in the beginning, just say for those of you that were here Sunday night with the Isaiah House Ministry, Brother Neil, banjo man, the gentleman that played the banjo, our brother in Christ, went home Friday morning to be with the Lord. We were so blessed, and as Brother Matt called me and told me about this, Brother Matt said, you know, what a tremendous treat it was that God bestowed upon us a blessing before he called him home. And we did have a blessing here Sunday night. And so continue to pray for that family. Also, let us remember a few announcements. Let's pray for Little Zion Baptist Church this week. Our deacons will meet today at 4 o'clock. Our Baptist women will meet today at 4 o'clock. Business meeting will be Wednesday following the Bible study. And the Valentine banquet will be Saturday, February the 9th. And today is the last sign-up day. So you need to sign up today. The sign-up sheet's in the back on the bulletin board. You sign up, you'll be blessed. And you'll enjoy that. It'll be a great treat as the primary youth and our youth treat us during that time, and it'd be a blessing. And don't forget to bring some non-perishable items for the food pantry as you come. It'd be a great way to build up our food bank, and so we'll ask God to bless that. Church directories are in. If you had your picture taken, the directories are in, and then once everybody gets their directories that had their pictures taken, there are a few extra that they sent, and if you'd like to have one, we'll distribute them as they are with what we have left. Men's prayer time every Tuesday morning at 9 o'clock. If you're not busy and you have at all about an hour, sometimes an hour and a half, to stop by on Friday morning. We meet over here in the conference room off of pastor's study and have just an awesome time in the Lord. What'd I say, brother?
Friday.
Tuesday morning. Don't come on Friday. Tuesday mornings. Thank you, Brother Ronnie. See, these guys keep me straight, don't they? Praise the Lord. All right, don't forget our ongoing ministries here. Bags of Hope Food Pantry, our Operation Christmas Child Shoebox Ministry, and our education box tops for education. Do want to say what a blessing it is to see God blessing us in our Sunday school program. We've continually seen our Sunday school program going up for the past few weeks, and if you're not in Sunday school, you come and be a part of it. What a blessing it is to gather together as God's children and just be a part of learning more in depth about the Lord Jesus Christ from his word. You'll be blessed by joining a Sunday school class, and we do appreciate all those that are coming. Just want to share a couple things with you this morning before we go to the Lord in a word of prayer. I guess everybody knows that this is Super Bowl Sunday. Everybody know that? No? Yeah. Well, you know, it's estimated that there's going to be 1.3 billion chicken wings distributed today or eaten today during the Super Bowl game. So I tell you that to be careful on your way home. If you see a chicken, slow down. They may not have wings to fly across the road. Also, I heard about a lady kind of arguing with her husband over buying a Super Bowl ticket. You know, they're quite expensive. They say the average Super Bowl ticket costs $5,600. The cheapest is $3,000-something. The highest is $175,000, almost $176,000. But she was kind of getting on about buying a Super Bowl ticket. And he told her, he said, well, hon, haven't you heard the news? And he said, I know the ticket was quite expensive, but he said they're selling hot dogs for $2. Let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, as we come before your throne today, we just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you for allowing us to be the humans we are. God, we just come into your very presence now. We thank you for coming into our midst. Father, may this time be set aside for your glory. Father, may we exalt Jesus Christ from this place this morning. Father, we're excited about what you're doing among us as your people. I thank you for touching the hearts and the lives of those that you're reaching out to. And Father, I know there's many more. So, Father, you bless them. You bless those that are going to come this morning and be baptized. Bless our new believers. Bless those that are on our prayer list. Father, we commend them all into your hands and ask that you just continually, in your undivided attention, bless us in every way, Lord, to grow in spirit. Father, thank you again for this time that we can come together. Thank you for our guest among us. I pray that they'll feel most welcome today. I pray most of all that they feel most welcome in your presence, Lord, that you'd speak to our hearts. Father, I pray today as well that if there be one or more here today that's never invited Jesus Christ to be Lord of their life and trusted you, Lord, by confessing their sins, that, Father, today would be the day they'd come. I pray that if there's any here that needs to move their membership and become a part of this family of God that you have your hand upon working through, I pray they'll come today. I just pray your will be done among our lives, Lord. Continue to bless us, Lord, and use us as your vessels for your glory. Father, as we labor each day in your vineyard, may we be found worthy of our calling. Oh, Father, what a joy and privilege we have bestowed upon us as your very children to labor for your glory each day. May you be glorified. May we exalt Jesus, our Lord, through our lives. Father, bless us now in all that we do, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Our scripture verse of the week is, "Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever." Matthew 6:13. All right, let's sing happy birthday. We have any birthdays or anniversaries? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Last week was the birthday. Yesterday was their anniversary, 40 years.
All right. Last week was Mary Faye's birthday, and yesterday was their anniversary, 40 years. Praise the Lord. Amen. All right. Brother Ronnie, you come and lead us, brother.
To 253 is our doxology. This is all turn to 253.
Thank you. Turn with me to 2 Chronicles, please. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. So good to see you in the house of the Lord this morning. What a blessing. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, we'll begin reading with verse 1. And it came to pass after this also that the children of Moab and the children of Ammon, and with them other besides the Ammonites, came against Jehoshaphat to battle. Then there came some that told Jehoshaphat, saying, there cometh a great multitude against thee from beyond the sea on this side Syria. And behold, they are be in Hazazan, Tamar, which is in Gedi. And Jehoshaphat feared and set himself to seek the Lord and proclaim a fast throughout all Judea. And Judea gathered themselves together to ask help of the Lord. Even out of all the cities of Judea, they came to seek the Lord. And Jehoshaphat stood in the congregation of Judah and Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court and said, O Lord God of our fathers, art not thou God in heaven? And rulest not thou over all the kingdoms of the heathen? And in thy hand is there not power and might, so that none is able to withstand thee? Art not thou our God, who didst drive out the inhabitants of this land before the people Israel, and gavest it to the seed of Abraham, thy friend, forever? And they dwelt therein and have built thee a sanctuary therein for thy name, saying, if when evil cometh upon us as the sword, judgment, or pestilence, or famine, we stand before this house and in thy presence, for thy name is in this house, and cry unto thee in our affliction, then thou wilt hear and help. And now behold the children of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir, whom thou wouldest not let Israel invade when they came out of the land of Egypt. But they turned from them and destroyed them not. Behold, I say, how they reward us to come to cast us out of the possession which thou hast given us to inherit. O our God, wilt thou not judge them? For we have no might against this great company that cometh against us, neither we know what to do, but our eyes are upon thee. And all Judah stood before the Lord with their little ones, their wives, and their children. Then upon Zazel, the son of Zechariah, the son of Benaiah, a son of Jeiel, the son of Mattaniah, a Levite of the sons of Asaph, came the Spirit of the Lord in the midst of the congregation. And he said, hearken ye, all Judea, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou, King Jehoshaphat, thus saith the Lord unto you, be not afraid nor dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Let's pray, please. Our Heavenly Father, as we come before you again, I come asking you, Father, in the name of Jesus. Sweet Holy Spirit of God, I pray for your help today. I pray that you'd hide me and use me as your vessel. I pray you'd minister to our hearts, that you would reveal to us your word, that you would speak to each and every heart that's here today, Lord. Father, may it be a refresher for us as your children, and may it be something new, Lord, for those that are just beginning their spiritual journey. But may you speak to each one of us as the need we might have, Lord. Father, we just thank you and love you for the sacrifice you made through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for dying on the cross of Calvary. Thank you for the resurrection. Thank you for the life that we have, that we can anchor ourselves in the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you that we can enjoy peace within our hearts after our Lord. Father, in all that you do today, we'll give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. Just hide me behind the cross and use me as your mouthpiece now, and I'll give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. E.M. Bounds once said that what the church needed today was not new machinery, not better machinery, and not new organizations. But what the church needed today was men of God that could be used by the Holy Spirit. Men of prayer. Men mighty in prayer. And I believe he said that based on what he knew from God revealing to him something. And that is, maybe you're aware of this and maybe you're not. But especially for our new believers, I want you to know that you will never succeed without prayer. Now, I'm not talking about succeeding for the world, by the way. Maybe some of us older believers might understand that a little better. We will never succeed in this world, and then I'll finish the statement, for the glory of God. Now, you might succeed in the world according to the worldly standards, but you will never succeed without prayer in your life. And it's very interesting that Jehoshaphat really wanted and had such an interest for the congregation, for the people to know this. Because he wanted them to be reminded of the glory of God. You know, God has really laid on my heart here recently just the mere fact that everything is to be done for the glory of God. We must do what we're doing for the glory of God. So many of us, I think, go through life and we fail, or maybe haven't come to the understanding. Maybe some have, but most haven't, I believe. Come to the greater understanding of what we do and the way we live and the people we are to live that life under the lordship and leadership of Jesus Christ for the glory of God, that God be exalted. And not only for the glory of God, but that he wanted them to experience the holiness of God. The holiness of God is the righteousness in Jesus Christ through the blood of the cross that is imputed to you and I when we confess our sins and invite Jesus to be Lord of our lives, that we have that right before the Heavenly Father to approach the throne. I mean, what a blessing that Jehoshaphat had within his life. And I think he had that blessing within his life because in verse 32, the Bible says that he followed after his father, Asa, which done right in the eyes of the Lord. And so being righteous before the Lord brings us to that understanding that we want others, or should desire to have others, to know the glory of God, to experience the holiness of God, to experience what we've experienced through the righteousness of Jesus Christ. In verse 1 it says, "And it came to pass after this also that the children of Moab and the children of Ammon, and with them the other beside the Ammonites, came into Jehoshaphat to battle." So we find right off here that there's a battle going on. You know, there's a battle always going on in our lives, most usually. What is your battle today? Or do you have a battle? Maybe the battle could be finances, it could be sickness, it could be health, it could be marriage problems, it could be Satan and his demons. There's all kinds of battles that we experience. But you notice that the Bible says that immediately he done some things here. First off, it says in verse 18 that he brought himself to the place of prostration, meaning he fell down before God on his face. He bowed before the Lord. He got down before the Lord. He was willing to humble himself before the Lord, recognizing who he was within himself. He was a participant. He was a follower of the Lord in verse 32. He was praising the Lord in verse 6 and 7. That's what we do when we come into the house of the Lord and we sing praise and hymn, song and hymn unto the Lord. We are praising the Lord. We're following through the words and prayerfully listening to the words that we're singing out to Christ. We're praising the Lord. We're asking the Lord. We're inviting the Lord to come into our hearts to prepare us for the breaking of the bread, for the getting ready for the time of worship. We come to praise the Lord. It's good to come and be with one another. God asks us to do that, to encourage one another, to be uplifting to one another. But we come to praise the Lord. We come to exalt him. We come to give glory to God. come to exalt Jesus Christ, which brings us into worship. It says, Jehoshaphat feared and set himself to seek the Lord and proclaim a fast throughout all Judea. He proclaimed a fast, means he was willing to sacrifice that which was physical for that which was spiritual. It was for the divine revelation of who Jesus Christ is, that Jesus Christ reveal himself to that one which is willing to pray and fast. And Judah gathered themselves together to ask help of the Lord, even out of all the cities of Judah that came to seek the Lord. And Jehoshaphat stood in the congregation of Judah and Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court, and he said, O Lord God of our fathers, O God, O God, art not thou the God of heaven? Aren't you the God of all? Aren't you the God of all existence? Aren't you the ruler over all the kingdoms of the heathen? Isn't your hand not the power and might of all, so that none can withstand you? Art not thou our God, who didst drive out the inhabitants of the land before the people of Israel, and gave it to the seed of Abraham, thy friend? Exalting, praising God for what he had done, for driving out the enemy. We come together, hopefully and prayerfully, to praise God for driving out the enemy. If you and I, as being under the lordship and leadership of Jesus Christ, have confessed our sins, invited Jesus to be Lord of our lives, and the Holy Spirit's living within us, we can just praise God this morning for knowing that he's driven out the inhabitant. He's driven out the enemy. He's driven out that one which caused us to want to desire to live the carnal way. Praise God that we're no longer following that pattern, no longer living that life, no longer doing those things. It's a change of life. It's a change of heart. And as one of the members in our class, Sunday school class this morning said, it's a commitment. It's a commitment to be dedicated to that. I've said quite often, and I truly believe this, if we aren't faithful and dedicated and committed to the cause in which God calls us to be, it's very doubtful we're going to be much help to somebody else. If we don't allow God to change us, if we don't allow God to mold us, if we don't allow God to bring us to be that person that he wants us to be, and to bring us to be the person he wants us to be, he wants us to do that for the glory of God. God, how can I do this? So we start crying out to God. We start praying. We're a participant, as Jehoshaphat was, after his father, Asa, but after our Father, our Heavenly Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, we become a participant. We become a follower. And we begin to do things the way God wants us to do them. We allow him to mold us in the fashion that he wants to mold us to be for his glory. And we praise him. But we notice that he cried out, and as he cried out, the Bible says here that they began to gather themselves. One man began to pray, and so many others began to come. Oh, the power of prayer. I know that many of you sitting here this morning realize and understand that, but there's some of you that have never come to that greater understanding of the power of prayer. My friends, listen. Listen to God this morning. You'll never succeed for the glory of God without prayer. You'll never succeed in this life for the glory of God without communing with God, without getting into the Word of God, without allowing God to reveal himself to you for being the living God, the all-knowing God, the all-present God, the all-powerful God that he is. We need God. We need our Lord. And he is there for our need to be met if we're just willing to submit and surrender. If we'll just let God have his way among us, how things can change. And many of you this morning in here have experienced that. How wonderful it is to know that we don't have any desire to go back to that old way of life. We don't have any desire to do the things we used to do. It's so different, and it's so much better than what we used to do. I used to think when I was rebellious and running and drinking and doing the things that I'd done, I thought I was having fun. I thought I was having fun. I thought it was the way to live. But when I gave my heart and life to Jesus Christ, I found out what it was really like to live, friends, as many of you have.
Oh, if you don't know what it's like to live, you're missing out. And God died. He sent His Son for you to enjoy life. Enjoy life in this fashion by participating and being a follower. By praying and seeking Him each and every new day to be that one that God wants you to be. To be dedicated and committed to the cause in which He calls you to be. Jehoshaphat stood in the congregation of Judah and Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court and said, "Oh God." Oh, he cried out to God. He realized his need for the Lord. And he says in verse 8, "And when they dwelt therein and have built thee a sanctuary therein for thy name, saying, if when evil cometh upon us as the sword and judgment or pestilence or famine, whatever it might be, whatever it might be, Lord, we stand before this house in thy presence and in thy name and cry unto thee. And you will hear us and help us." And he says in verse 10, "And now behold, the children of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir, whom they wouldest not let Israel invade." You remember when they were coming up through the wilderness and they had just crossed the Red Sea and they were wanting access to come through Edom and Moab and Ammon, and they wouldn't allow them to come through, and they had to go around. And he says here, "And now behold, they reward us," in verse 11, "to come to cast us out of the possession which you have given us, Lord, which thou hast given us to inherit." In other words, he's saying they want to return evil for good here. We was good to them when we came up through the promise, through the wilderness. But now they want to come against us and they want to take our possession. They want to take what we've had inherited to us. I mean, God has bestowed so much in your lives and my lives through the inheritance. It's like the devil wants to come and rob you. He wants to steal from you. He wants to take from you. He wants to cause these battles and this affliction to come upon you, that he'd take your attention away from God. That it leads you off in a different direction, that it gets your mind on something else, something worldly. That you'd forget about God. My friends, you need God. And you need to seek God. And you need to pray out to God. Because if you don't pray, you'll never succeed for the glory of God. And that's what this whole purpose is about for your life and my life. To bring glory to God. You know what brings glory to God? Seeing people be baptized. Seeing people walk down the aisle and confessing their sins, saying, "I'm tired of this wretched life. I'm tired of this ugly mess. I'm tired of being in the mud pit. I want a new life. I want a new way of experiencing the peace of God." And God offers that through Jesus Christ. And I want to accept that today. I want to invite Jesus to be Lord of my life. And then you see a turnabout in their life. And this morning we read from Genesis about Joseph. And I was sharing with them this morning a couple of things as our brother Matt led us in our study this morning. The fact of what envy does. See, the brothers envied Joseph. They envied Joseph. They didn't like it that it seemed that he was being blessed. And they weren't going to get what they had coming to them. And then envy's got a sister called malice. And malice is just saying that I just hate to see anybody do better than I do. And together they call slander. Slander is criticism. And so rather than to criticize people that walk down the aisle and give their hearts and lives to Jesus, we need to uplift them. We need to go to the rescue. We need to pray for them. We need to bring them into the fold as a loving child of God. Too often people walk down the aisle and they give their hearts and lives to Jesus and they go out still being infants, still being baby lambs. And they make a mistake and somebody, the first thing you say, "I knew it wasn't going to last. I knew they weren't going to make it." Well, my friends, I'll tell you, if you'll pray and ask God, God will tell you, rather than to criticize, rather than to be the sister, either malice or envy, go to that person. Pick them up. Encourage them to get back into the fold. Encourage them to get back where they belong. They're just a baby. Now that don't give us a license to do it. That don't mean just because you are an infant that you can go out here and just do whatever you want to do. But it does mean that you're a babe in Christ. You're growing. And you come to the place of Jehoshaphat. And Jehoshaphat had led his congregation of people to believe in knowing that there was help in the Lord. There was help in the time of affliction. There was help in the time of judgment. There was help in the time of pestilence. There was help in the time of famine. And all through the scriptures, we see how God came to help. He came to rescue those that were in need. And he's come to rescue you this morning, whatever your need might be. He's come to rescue you today from the battle. As he says there in the last verse we read this morning, verse 15. This is God's battle. This is God's battle.
Behold, I say how they reward us to come to cast us out of the possession and that thou hast given us to inherit. O our God, wilt not thou judge them? For we have no might against this great company that cometh against us, neither know we know what to do.
You know, sometimes, as I've shared with you before, we just don't know what to do. Other than, as a believer in Jesus Christ, knowing that Christ delivered us from our sin and set us on the straight and narrow, we do know that we can cry out to the Lord. That's what he done here in verse 9. He said, we came to this place, this house where thy presence was and thy name was put forth, and we cried out and you heard us and you helped us.
He says, we don't know what to do. But notice what he goes on to say in verse 12. But our eyes are upon you.
What's he saying? He's saying there, Lord, this is way over my head. I don't know how to handle it. I don't know what to do. The battle's too big. I can't handle it. I'm going under. I don't know what to do, Lord. But notice he says, you do. He knows that the Lord has delivered him. He knows he can depend upon the Lord. And he knows in the worst of battles, and it says there in the first two or three verses of the chapter, that the battle was becoming more fierce. When it says there was a great multitude, and he told him and revealed to him when they came and told Jehoshaphat where the battle was coming from and where they were getting close. And Jehoshaphat knew that he needed to turn to the Lord. He didn't need to depend upon the army. He didn't need to depend upon his advisors. And there's times that we need to seek counsel among one another. But he knew that his refuge was in the Lord. He knew he needed the Lord. So it's so important that we realize we need the Lord. And we need to follow the Lord. And we need to be those participants that God's called us to be. That we need to be those prayer warriors that God's called us to be. Seeking his divine will. That the empowerment of the Holy Spirit will be upon us for the glory of God. For God's glory. And then he says there was in verse 13, and all of Judah stood before the Lord with their little ones, their wives, and their children. They all stood before the Lord. The children weren't sent off to a gymnasium or somewhere else, friends. No, the Bible says here even the little ones stood before the Lord. Oh, they wanted to teach those little ones about the love of God. They wanted those little ones to experience the holiness and the righteousness of a God that loves them. They wanted them to experience the glory of God, to be in the very presence of God in the sanctuary with the rest of the people. I know today I think we've got things a little bit backwards. I don't know about you. Praise God, we've got some teachers that are teaching them in the back. But it says here they stood before the Lord, even the little ones. And then upon Jehaziel, the son of Zechariah, and the son of Benaiah, the son of Jeiel, and the son of Mattaniah, a Levite of the sons of Asaph, came the Spirit of the Lord in the midst of congregation. I mean, the Spirit of God just came in on them. Just filled the house with the power and the presence of God himself. Have you ever experienced that? A lot of you probably have. But I fear there's probably a lot of you here that's never experienced the real presence of God. There's been times, and I've heard testimony from some of you, but I can't help but to remember the few times that I've experienced the almighty power, the fullest presence of God in the room where I was. He's here, folks. He's here and He loves you. And He wants you to know that if you'll just surrender to Him and trust Him, I don't know what to do, but I know you do, Lord. I know you know all about the battle. I know you know where the battle is. You know where I am in the battle. And you're my help. You're my refuge. And He said, being filled with the Holy Spirit, as we all need the Holy Spirit, hearken ye all, Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou King Jehoshaphat. So He tells them all, thus saith the Lord, thus saith the Lord, thus saith the Lord, be not afraid. Don't be dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. In other words, He's saying to you this morning, don't be dismayed. The battle is mine. I've already won the battle. He won the battle at Calvary on the cross. And by the resurrection, the battle's been won. But the battle is God's. If you'll just give it to God, He says, don't be dismayed, but know that I will deliver you and destroy the inhabitants that's coming towards you. That one in which is strategizing right now, that as many of you well know, is strategizing right now. If you're not facing a battle, you better get ready for one. Because the devil's not going to leave you alone if you're doing what you need to be doing for the glory of God. And you need to be in prayer. Because without prayer, you're not going to succeed for the glory of God. Please, friends, listen to what He's saying. I will deliver you. I will destroy the inhabitants. I know where the battle lies. I know what He's trying to do in strategizing to tear you down, to cause you to fall, to get you to stumble. I'm aware of that. And this battle's mine because you're my son and you're my daughter and I love you. My friends, trust the Lord. As our ladies and Brother Ronnie comes, what about you? What about you? In verse 15, may the Spirit come upon you this morning and let you know that you do not need to be dismayed, that the battle's not yours, but that Jesus will deliver you and destroy the enemy. So I say to you this morning, cry out, call out to Jesus. Call out to Jesus. There is something about that name, friends. Jesus. Jesus, the friend of all. Maybe you have a need this morning. Maybe you need to come and surrender your heart and life to the Lord. Experience the peace and presence of God. Maybe you need to come move your membership. Oh, my friends, don't hesitate with whatever God's laid on your heart to do. Do it and do it for the glory of God. Do it to bring a smile to God's face. Do what you do for the glory of God. As we stand, sing what number, brother? 275. Would you stand, please?
Somebody come up here with me. You all sit right here if you would, and we're going to go back and baptize, and I'm going to set, get some people ready to baptize, and we'll come back out, get y'all come around, get right in the church. Be seated, please.
While we're waiting, just turn your hymn books to 445.
Today, upon your profession of faith, Haley, and on behalf of Fellowship Baptist Church and the authority of Jesus Christ, baptizing you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Ghost. come, my brother Robert, upon your profession of faith, by trusting the blood of Jesus Christ, and on behalf of Fellowship Baptist Church and the authority of Jesus Christ, baptizing you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Just take your handbooks, turn to 455. It's all staying as we're saying. I must tell Jesus all of my trials. I cannot bear my distress, sweet Ali will help me. He loves and cares for his own. I must tell Jesus, I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus. Jesus can help me, Jesus alone. I must tell Jesus all of my trouble. He is a kind and passionate friend. If I will trust him, he will deliver. Make can be seated if you want to. Our next song is 456. Precious Lord, take my hand.
Scooter.